Well, hey, good to see you all. I was up late last night watching the Patriots win, and so that was good. I told you last week, I joked that if the Patriots lost today, because really they shouldn't have lost the game last night, then I was going to re-preach Jonathan Edwards' sermon from 1741, Sinners in the Hand of an Angry God, and which is a remarkable sermon. When I was in high school, in public high school, that was in our textbook. We read that in our public high school, that sermon. And I just imagine, I mean, I promise you, no sermon I've ever preached is going to end up in a high school textbook 300 years from now. But I give it my best effort. There's a couple games on TV, football games, and I know there's one this afternoon. I think it's the only game that's really important to anybody in here, and because we've got some Dallas Cowboy fans and we've got some Green Bay Packers fans that attend here to this church. And that just lets you know, if you're a guest here, that we accept everybody at our church. We all kinds of people from all different walks of life, we let them come here. So really, you know, you're welcome. You're welcome here. And the proof is right there. I want to look at our scripture that we'll focus in on a little bit. We've got a few that we're going to look at, but the main one for this morning is here in Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. And it is words of Jesus. He said to his disciples, "If any of you want to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross, and follow me." Now, there's two groups of people in the room here today. There are those who've made the decision to follow Jesus, and there are those who haven't. Either you don't believe there's a God, you don't believe maybe that Jesus is the Son of God, maybe you're not sure, and so you're here this morning trying to figure it out, but for whatever reason, you haven't made the decision to follow him. Now, for those who haven't made that decision, you don't believe Jesus is the Son of God, you haven't made the decision to give your life to him and follow him, what I hope this morning is that you'll hear just a little bit about the good news of Jesus, that he is a good guy who is God, who is miraculous, who has all power in heaven and earth, and who knows who you are and he loves you. And he came and died on the cross for you, for us, for mankind. I want you to hear that this morning. For those of you who are Christian, I'm going to talk to you a little bit like Jesus talked here. And he didn't kind of hold back any punches. You must turn from your selfish ways. And so any of you, you've been a Christian this morning for longer than a year. We're going to take a few times this morning to be a bit, I don't want to say stern or we're just going to tell the truth during parts of this message. So if you're not a Christian, don't feel bad. I'm not trying to make you feel bad. I'm trying to make the Christians feel bad. And if you're kind of on the brink, you're deciding whether or not you're to follow Jesus, what I want you to know is it's not just a decision you make one day, but you are giving him your entire life. Your entire life. You're saying you are Lord over it all. You are God over every area of my life. And we, as Christians, even me as a pastor, we struggle with that sometimes. And there's things you like to hold on to, and God's asking you to give up. And so it's a process, as we'll see, and we'll go through this. Let me stop here. Let me just pray before we get into this. We pray, Jesus, that your words, that the words of the scripture in the Bible will change us today. Change our hearts, correct us, convict us, transform us, free us, deliver us, and fill us with the fruit of the Holy Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. May these things burst forward out of our hearts this morning because of your word and your power. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I had the opportunity yesterday to see Pastor Chris and Anna's new baby, and so that was good. Now, think about this. A newborn baby, there is a lot to learn for that child. Like, the child's going to have to learn one day how hairy her father is. Like, that's just, you know, there's bad things to learn, there's good things to learn, but there's a lot that kid has to learn going forward in their life. When you make the decision to follow Jesus, it is a drastic moment in your life. When Jesus talks about the moment you decide to follow him, he compares it to being born again. That you are starting now a brand new life. Everything changes. That baby, it has to learn everything. It doesn't even know how to sleep through the night yet. You think about how basic that is. I mean, wouldn't her, I saw Anna yesterday. I mean, she's praying for a miracle. Pray for that baby to sleep through the night. The conversation, maybe that was off the record, but the baby doesn't know how to sleep through the night. Think about all some of the stupid things that the baby has to learn over the next few months. The baby needs to learn how to burp, all right? It is going to be, is that a three-month process till the baby learns how to burp itself? And then you spend, at least for us, we're trying to teach your kids not to burp at the table, you know? But they have to learn how to burp, and it's going to have to learn how to walk, how to crawl, those can be in separate order. It has to learn how to laugh, learn how to use a toilet, learn how to eat solid food. Just simple little things that we take for granted that we've done for our entire life that the baby's going to have to learn. Now, socially, it's going to have to learn how to share. It's going to have to learn how to give. It's going to have to learn how to forgive. Those are challenging things. It's going to have to learn how to obey its parents. It's going to have to learn what things to fear and what things not to fear. It's a big process. That's a lot. And for you, when you make the decision to follow Jesus, it is as if you are born again. You have to relearn everything in your entire life. You have to learn how to share. You have to learn how to give. You have to learn how to forgive. You have to learn how, some of you are going to have to learn how to talk, all right? Because, you know why. Everything in your life changes. You are learning. The way you talk with the way you interact with your spouse is different. The way you interact with your boss is different. The way you interact with other people on Route 16 is different. Everything changes. And you have to learn it all. It's a big deal. And that's what we're talking about this morning. And what happens kind of statistically or stereotypically in the American church, though this is churches across many denominations, but here in the United States, new Christians, they tend to be abandoned in the cradle. So if we think of a new Christian as being an infant because they've been born again, they're often just left to their own devices. And it's just like, man, that was great. You made a decision, and then that's it. And then that's kind of as much interaction or as much direction as they're given. And we know, because people much smarter than I have been studying this for many decades, is that approach is hurting new Christians, and it's hurting those who survive that, those who continue to have a faith a few years down the road. It just creates now a kind of a bunch of babies or a bunch of underdeveloped individuals who aren't able to live the life that God has for them. Now, statistically, we know that just under 25% of those who make a decision for Jesus are water baptized. We talked about water baptism the first week in the series a couple weeks ago, and that's your first step. You make the decision to follow Jesus. Jesus says, now, be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's your step number one, but just one out of four people is ever taking that step. Why? Because they're not being taught. They're not being shown. They're not being encouraged. They're not being led to take that step. I should have memorized this. 45% of people who regularly attend the church read the Bible more than once a week. So 55% of people who attend church don't even read the Bible once a week. And how do we as individuals know that we're following God the right way? Because so many people all over the world have different ideas of who God is. How do we know that? We get that direction through the Bible. We get that understanding through the Bible. Lifeway Research Group found that 90% of churchgoers desire to please Jesus and honor him in all they do. And that if we were to poll you guys here, then it's probably going to be 90%. If I were to ask you a question, how many of you want to honor Jesus with your life and please him in everything you do? Everybody's going to, oh yeah, absolutely. I want to do that. How are we going to know how to honor him with our life if we're not reading the scriptures, if we're not reading the words of Jesus and how he teaches us, how he directs us to live and to follow him? We desire to please Jesus, but we take very little time to find out if we actually are. And this is not the fault of the new Christian. This is the fault of those of us who we've been a Christian a year or more, but we're still not reading our Bible. We are talking about how we'd like to honor the Lord, but we're really not putting any effort into following him. One of the reasons that new Christians are being abandoned in the cradle or neglected in the cradle is because older Christians are never leaving it. They're never leaving past the infant stage in their walk with Jesus. Now, the Apostle Paul, he wrote about this in 1 Corinthians 3, and I'm going to put that up on the screen for you. It says, "Dear brothers and sisters, when I was with you, I couldn't talk to you as I would spiritual people." He just insulted them. "I had to talk as though you belonged to this world. I had to talk as if you weren't Christians or as though you were infants in the Christian life. I had to feed you with milk, not with solid food, because you weren't ready for anything stronger and you still aren't ready." Hey, you're supposed to leave the cradle here at some point. You're supposed to grow up into strong men and women of God. And really, what happens is we have no idea how to do that because no one who's gone before us has taught us how to do that. And it's kind of the problem in society now where we have dads who never had dads raising kids who don't know how to be dads, because I've never had a dad, I don't know how to be a dad, and so it's just compounding the problem here. What's the alternative? And that's the scripture we read before in Matthew 16. Jesus said to his disciples, "If you want to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross, and follow me." You decide to be a disciple. You're not just going to show up. You're going to follow. So, question, what is a disciple? In the Gospels, which is in the first four books of the New Testament, written by a guy named Matthew, a guy named Mark, a guy named Luke, and a guy named John, recorded by these guys. And they at this point, in each of their accounts, when Jesus says to someone, "Come and follow me," and they make the decision to follow him, these guys left jobs and careers to begin following Jesus. From the point they decided to follow Jesus, from then on, they were called disciples. So you've made a decision, all right, I'm going to follow you, Jesus. You could categorize yourself as a disciple. We don't really know what that is, so let's break that down. The word disciple, so when the New Testament was written, it was written in Greek. And so that Greek word for disciple is mathetes, and it literally means learner. So stop right there, and let's look at that. A disciple means you're a learner. A disciple is a learner. And that changes it when we understand what a disciple is. It's not just showing up at church. It's not just saying, "I believe." A disciple is a learner. Now, let me break down some very obvious, well, at least the first one's very obvious things about learners. And so conversely about a disciple. If you're a disciple, you're a learner. Here's what learners do. Learners learn. I felt stupid writing that down on the paper, and I was rethinking it over the weekend. Like, maybe I shouldn't start off saying that because people will probably walk out of the room, but hasn't happened yet. Now, think about this. Think about if you remember grade school, if you've got kids, what think about the classroom setting of a fifth grade class before recess. 10, 15 minutes, 20 minutes before recess. Is there a lot of learning going on during that time? Or the first few days before vacation break? Is there a lot of learning going on? No, because they're just existing in the classroom there. They're not thinking about learning anything. They're thinking about recess. Now, think about church before lunch. How many people are sitting in my message right now thinking like, with their pen and paper out and their Bible open and like, I can't wait to learn this morning? No, they're thinking about lunch and they're thinking, Las Palmas is $1.99 kids meals today. Maybe we should go there. Or maybe La Festa, or maybe we should go to Dos Amigos, or maybe we should go to the mall. You're not thinking. You're distracted. Growing up, when I was in church, and I would, you know, when I was in church, as a kid, as a teenager, there was a huge clock on the back wall. Huge clock. And so you'd sit there. I mean, I was a kid. I'm going to be honest with you. I still daydream. Sometimes I daydream while I'm talking. You know, I just mentioned all those restaurants. I begin to daydream. But what would happen is, eventually, once your seat got sore, I would always, like, just turn and look at the back of the room to try to, like, figure out, how much longer is this going to be? Especially when we had, you know, our own pastor who we loved, we kind of knew his rhythm. So we kind of expect when it would happen. But if there was a guest speaker, man, you didn't know whatever was going to happen. And I don't remember where I was, but we had a guest speaker, and this will never happen unless it is the ultimate mighty move of God. And we won't fabricate this at all. But the lady didn't get done speaking. I don't joke. I'm not lying. I'm not exaggerating. There are people in this room who will testify to this. I wasn't there, praise the Lord. She went till 3 o'clock. The service started at 10 a.m. They didn't give a dismissal till 3 p.m. What in the world? I just can't even imagine. Imagine sitting in the service, you're looking back at that big clock, you're like, it's 12:30. It's 2:30. Oh, my word. True stories. And what would happen to me is I would be excited, like, all right, you know, there's a preaching of the word, God do something in my life. And then eventually I'm like, I just want to leave. And I'm not learning anymore. That was immature of me. And I wouldn't say wrong, just immature. But you have to make a decision. I'm going to learn. I'm not just going to show up at church. I'm not just going to, for my Christian life to be, I go to church once a week. You've got to make the decision to learn. Now, at our church, we have an eight-week, hey, John, will you give me that book? We have an eight-week program called Follow. And so it's 8 weeks long, and you meet with a coach one-on-one for 8 weeks. So it's 8 hours. And in that 8 hours, you're focused on seven things. You're focused on learning. Learning to be with Jesus. Learning to listen to him talk to you. I had a conversation with my 8-year-old last week, I think, or the week before. And so it's bedtime. He's like, Dad, I can't sleep. I'm like, well, just talk to God. He's like, well, why? God already knows everything. Why should I talk to him? And we had that. And I'm like, well, maybe God wants to talk to you. Maybe you should listen. Well, how do I listen to God? Well, be quiet. Well, let's try that. And just ask them to talk to you. And they'll speak to your heart. And begin to listen. So I'm trying to teach my 8-year-old how to learn to listen. You could be 88 years old and you've never learned that. That's an important thing to learn. God wants to talk to you. Learning how to heal. Now, I went through this in 2014, and I don't know the exact, we had 34 people who went through follow this year, just in 2016, excuse me, last year, and over the 3 years, Larry, you can yell it out to me if you've ever added it up. How many people have gone through follow? 57 people in this room gone through follow, and I had to learn how to heal. When I went through this, there's still things that you got to work through. It's too painful to deal with, and you don't give God access to it. You have to learn how to give God access to every broken area in your heart. Learning how to influence, learning how to love, learn how to pray. Not just some of you, because you've come from, depending on your faith background, you have memorized prayers that you just recite. God wants to hear from you. There's nothing wrong with a reciting a prayer, but God wants to hear from you. How do you talk to God about what's inside of you? And then learning how to manage. We are stewards of what God's given us, and we have to learn how to manage everything that He's given us. Your job, your family, your cars, your house, your clothes, your pets, all of it is God's. Everything you have is God's. You're the manager of it. And so how do you treat God's stuff? How do you steward God's stuff? That's a big thing to learn. And sometimes I'll encourage people to sign up for follow, or Larry or Pastor John will encourage people to sign up for follow, and people can say, oh, I already know all that. I've been a Christian for a long time. I already know all that. Or sometimes I'll meet with people for the first time, and I'm like, so, how's it going? They're like, well, yeah, I already know everything in here. So, listen, that's not someone who's a learner. Learners can learn anywhere. I can go to elementary school and learn. I probably should. I have to figure out how do they do math nowadays. I can't get it. So there's things I can learn. I still have problems with the 12s. You know, anything past 12 on the multiplication table, I am stuck. Give me, thankfully the calculator on the iPhone is right there. You don't even have to unlock the phone. It's the calculator. Thank the Lord for modern technology. So what you're saying is the qualities of a Jesus follower: learning to be with Jesus, learning to listen, learning to heal, learning to influence, learning to love, learning to pray, learning to marinate. There's nothing you can learn in any of these areas. There's no place you need to grow in any of these areas at all. All right, well, there's nothing we can do for you, I guess, apparently. There's nothing we'll ever do to help you grow in your walk with the Lord if you have that posture and you have that attitude. Now, which moves us into our next thing about learners. Learners are humble. Here's why: because you can't learn if you know it all. If you know it all, you can't learn, because there's nothing to learn. But there's always, the person who desires to learn can always learn something. Your college professor may be the biggest nutcase dingbat in the world. You can learn something from that. You can learn how to not be a nutcase dingbat. There's always something to learn. You have the worst manager, the worst boss. You can learn how not to be them. Your parents were the worst. You can learn how to not be them. There is always something to learn. You can learn stuff from 4-year-olds. You can learn stuff from 8-year-olds. You can learn, the new bad words of today's modern age from 8-year-old. A learner can always learn. But you can only do that when you are humble. People who've gone through follow, and a little bit I'm going to be talking about follow here, this program, because I want every single one of you to go through it. Now, who's gone through follow within our church? We've had credentialed ministers go through it. We've had Bible school graduates. We've had Bible school valedictorians. We've had those who've been Christians for over 5 decades go through follow. And those who opened themselves up to God were changed. People who've been Christians for over 5 decades who probably they've read all these Bible verses before. They've heard all these things before. But it said, there's something, God, for you to have me learn through this. They learned something. Their lives were changed through a simple process. The learners got something. In order to learn, we have to admit there's something we don't know. Now, learners learn. Learners are humble. Learners change. When you think about, all right, so my early days in marriage, and my wife is here. I always appreciate it when she's in service with me, not because she skips church, because she usually, most weeks, she's working in the kids' wing and serving and preaching down there herself. But so I can speak about this openly. You don't think I'm exaggerating or making things up. But early in our marriage, it wasn't working. It wasn't going well. And I knew that from my perspective, like, this isn't working. This is not going well. And if something doesn't change, this is not going to last, or this is going to be really a miserable majority of my life. And for her as well. And so I had to learn what I'm doing wrong so I can make the changes and adjustments necessary for myself to be a Christian man within my marriage. Now, if Michelle never changed and Michelle never did anything on her side, I still needed to learn from my side how to serve her like Jesus served the church. Thankfully, praise the Lord, God changed her as well. But not because I tried to get her to change, but because she is a learner. And so she strived to learn. She humbled herself before God, and she allowed God to change her. And that's the only reason we love each other, is because of God. Because if God wasn't here, I would have quit a long time ago, and I'm probably sure Michelle would have too, because what's the point? Like, hey, we gave this a good effort. It's been 3 months. Like, let's not continue this any further. Humility allows you to learn, and when you learn, you change. Remember, we're born again. We are relearning everything in our entire life. And as you learn, you change. And you change a lot. We had a... I don't think she's here this morning, so I can talk behind her back. We had a young lady, she's in her 20s, and so she came to our church. First time here was maybe 2 or 3 months ago. And someone else from the church saw her outside of the church service 2 weeks. She had been to our church 2 weeks. And he said, I didn't even recognize her because of the work that God did in her heart in 2 Sundays changed even her outward appearance in public, because she was smiling, which was a miracle. It was a miracle. When you learn, you change. Everything. Everything changes. I changed. Who I was when I was 26 and we got married is not who I am now, because I allowed God to change me. He corrected me. He rebuked me. Sometimes God even assaulted me, I think. And it was a beat down. And I would get up like all bloodied and dizzied. I'm like, yes, God. You know, not obviously, not literally here I'm speaking about, but like figuratively, like God was correcting me, exposing like the sin in my life. I was a pretty miserable guy here. We have to relearn. I mean, it's to some of you, how do you not live sober? How do you live in abstinence? How do you tell the truth on your taxes? You're relearning just your entire life. Every way, everything you've ever done now is different because you say, God, you're Jesus, you are the Lord of my life. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to honor you. I'm going to try to honor you. I'm going to do my best to honor you. I want to honor you in every way, in every area, in every moment. And so what happens? Learners learn, learners are humble, learners change, and then here's the last part, and you thought I was like hitting, I was beating you up before, like we're getting ready for it. I might take off my sweatshirt. Learners lead. Hey, I don't know if you've ever heard the adage, leaders are readers, and you can read a lot of books but not be a leader, but you cannot be a leader if you don't read. So occasionally we come across, as I, as a pastor, I interact with young pastors or young people who are in college hoping to be pastors one day. And occasionally they'll have a few who just communicate like, oh yeah, I don't like reading, I never read. All right, so I'll never hire you. I just can't. I just can't, because you'll never become who God wants you to be if you're not reading, if you're not developing yourself, if you're not trying to become more, if you're not trying to experience God more, if you're not trying to grow in your doctrine and your understanding of God and your love for God and in your application of the cross into your daily life. If you don't read, then you're not a leader. You're just existing. So you have great hopes and great aspirations, but if you don't read, you'll never become it. So those of you who think like, man, I really want that promotion at my job. More pay, more benefits, better desk chair, and you're just thinking, I want that. What you got to do is you got to begin reading, developing yourself, becoming more than what you are right now. And that's what gives you the open door into leadership, learning. When you learn, you become a leader. The disciples, when Jesus spoke to them and said, hey, follow me, they weren't invited into a passive process of being fed. I'm going to cough for a second, excuse me. Party. I apologize for that. The early followers of Jesus, they were learning to lead. It wasn't just like Jesus said, hey, follow me, let's sit around in a circle, let me teach you these deep truths about God the Father, let me teach you about these deep truths of heaven. He was training them and inviting them to change the world. And the same thing is true for you. When Jesus calls on your heart this morning or next week, or if he already did it a couple weeks ago at Christmas Eve service, he's not inviting you to join a church. He's not inviting you to attend a service. He's not inviting you to just change your Facebook religious status. He's invited you to change the world, to take the good news that you've received to the world, to do something with the transformation he's done in your life. Hebrews chapter 5, I want to read this together. Chapter 5, starting at verse 11. And so the author of Hebrews, it could have been Paul who wrote 1 Corinthians, but we're not exactly sure who wrote it. So the author of Hebrews had this to say. We have much to say about this, but it is hard to make it clear to you because you no longer try to understand. Stop right there. You've stopped being a learner. You made a decision at one point, but you've stopped trying to learn. Next verse. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you should be leaders right now. You've learned. You should have been learning. You should now be leaders. Instead, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching of righteousness. If you've been a Christian, and I'm not sure, really sure how to timeline this. Definitely, if you've been a Christian, probably over, we'll say 3.5 years, because we know the disciples followed Jesus for 3.5 years before, and then Jesus left. He sent them out into the world. And we know the Apostle Paul, he had a dramatic conversion when he was traveling to Damascus to kill Christians. He had a dramatic conversion, and then he went to Jerusalem and studied for 3.5 years before he then began his missionary journeys. So, if you've been a Christian longer than 3.5 years, I think we should write that down. I think that is a biblical principle there that just came. I don't want to forget that 3.5 years. If you've been a Christian longer than 3.5 years and you're not leading, you are in error. And just let me expound on that so you can capture this. You are in major error. There is something significantly wrong with your walk with Jesus if you've been a Christian for more than 3.5 years and you're not leading. We all have different gifts. We all have different abilities. All right? This morning, there was potentially a major catastrophe for someone. One of the stalls didn't have toilet paper in it. That would have been really bad news for a first-time guest. And just imagine, talk about being stranded. And so you may not have any natural gifts in the world, but you could rise to be the leader of the tissue paper. You can lead an area. So it is not about your giftings or your IQ or your natural ability, because we all are different. But God knows that. We all have different things that we're working through. God knows that. We all have different places that God wants us to lead. And so that's all right. Whether you're leading one person, and that's you're a single mom and you have a kid and you're leading that child, you're leading them to prayer, you're leading them to read their Bible, you're leading them, you may not have all the answers, but you're helping, you're talking about that with them, I don't know, but let's begin to study God's word together. You're leading that one child, well, that's leadership. Whether it's here, and you're a teenager, and you're texting your friends, and finding out where they are, trying to give them rides to church, that's leadership. You exit the church and you walk in the parking lot and you see garbage on the ground and you pick it up and you throw it away. That's leadership. It's not about preaching. It's not about having PhDs. It's about being leaders. Leaders that say, I don't just walk past problems, I do something about it. I don't just exist, I invest. And if you're not a leader, then what did he say here in verse 13? You're not acquainted with the teaching of righteousness. You said you're going to follow Jesus, but if after all this time you're not a leader, then something happened and you're not really following. You got stuck somewhere. You're still hanging out in the crib. You gotta move a little bit. You gotta do something here. People who'd rather feed than lead are in an arrested development. When we say, I just want to feed. It's not a season for me to serve. We're just going to sit back, soak it all in. It happens after an injury. You should do that when you first come to Christ. But the rest of you, what it is lazy. You're just lazy. Because I know for me, if I'm going to feed, instead of doing anything, like instead of being active, instead of being disciplined, why do I do that? Because I'm lazy, I'm worried about my own comfort. And I just like texting Michelle, make me more buffalo chicken calzones, please. We're disciples, we're learners. We learn, we humble ourselves, we change, and we lead. Once out of infancy, they should no longer need to be fed, but they should be feeding others. So what do we do? What do you do? What do I do? What do we do? We've been confronted with Scripture. As your pastor, I haven't held back any punches this morning. So we don't just walk out of here feeling miserable. When God convicts us and confronts us, these are moments of excitement for the Christian. Because God doesn't like confront us to yell at us and put us down. So it's not like maybe how you grew up. It's not, Nate, you idiot! How did you, why would you do this? And I hate you, and you're miserable, and you're a failure. You'll never do it. No, when God says, Nate, you idiot, I freed you from that. Come on, let's go. We talked about this, I don't know if it was Easter last year, but Peter, he abandoned Jesus. When Jesus was being crucified, Peter abandoned him, Jesus was within earshot of Peter and heard Peter saying, I don't know that guy, I don't know that guy, I'm not one of them, I don't know that guy. Peter's cursing to like try to fit in, and Jesus hears all that. Jesus is then killed. Peter feels just horrified. I'm a loser. I am worthless. I've wasted everything that God's ever given me. And Jesus appears, because he's resurrected from the grave, and he shows up to the disciples. And Peter jumps, they're out fishing because they've gone back to their own life. And so it's this challenge, like, I've screwed up. I'm a failure. And so what you would do is you would stop coming to church. What they did is they went back to their old jobs. They started fishing again. We abandoned them. He's dead. He's gone. We're worthless. And Jesus showed up to them, and Peter was like, I can't believe there's Jesus. He jumps out of the boat. He's swimming, and he catches up with Jesus on the shore. When the other disciples come back, Jesus cooked them breakfast. Cooked Peter breakfast and was sitting with him, talking with him. And the conversation could have been, hey, Peter, man, I'm sure you feel pretty embarrassed denying that you knew me. But you're the rock I'm going to build this church on. And I love you, and I forgive you. It's time to lead. And for you, you may be a complete loser. I'm not going to try to talk you out of that. But God loves you. He loves you as much today as he ever has. So when you were 9 weeks old, God loves you as much today as he did then. And no matter what you do, if you leave here cursing God, hating God, he's going to love you as much moments from now as he does right now. He'll love you as much 10 years from now as he ever does right now. There's nothing you can ever do to get God to love you more. But conversely, there's nothing you could ever do to get God to love you less. He loves you. But he's not going to let you stay where you are. He has saved you. He's redeemed you. He's called you by name. He's called you to lead. He's called you to change the world. And he's inviting you to that. Not to play church, not to sit down, not to be comfortable, not to feed. He has done these things in your life that you may impact the world. Thank you. So what do you do? Well, let's break it down real simple, right? Because changing the whole world, that just seems huge. Step here within Restoration Church. If you've never gone through follow, that's a step for you. To be discipled. To learn these things. And again, don't have the posture of like, well, I've already been discipled before. Well, I've already learned all these things before. Don't get stuck in that. All right? Check that in your heart right now. Like, where does that come from? That sin of pride that... check that. You make the decision, all right, I'm going to go through follow. Those of you, you're new to Christ, this is be water baptized, jump into follow. Depending on when they start, you can do those simultaneously. It doesn't matter the order. Do that. Jump into that. Those of you who are Christian, you've been a Christian for a long time. Maybe you're new to Restoration Church, but you've been a Christian for a long time. You just moved to the area. We want you still to go through follow. I've gone through follow. Pastor John has. Pastor Chris has. All of our deacons have. We've all gone through this. And then there's a coach's training, and you go through that. Because what you're saying is, I'm going to lead. And whether you can personally one-on-one disciple one person a year, that's 16 hours in your entire, or excuse me, 8 hours in an entire year. And you think, I'm too busy to do follow, to be a follow coach. Your priorities are just out, are just messed up if you don't have 8 hours in 1 year to lead and disciple someone, to be a coach for someone. And I know my wife, and I'll talk about her because she impresses me. She's got four kids. She's leading the kids department. She was going through her bachelor's degree online and doing that, and she was a follow coach for two people at a time, and then when they were done, she'd take on two more people in the midst of all of that. And then we'd have kind of some other people kind of argue against us, like, I don't have time to do that. Like, well, quit sleeping 14 hours a night. Like, you're 20 years old. You've got no kids, a part-time job. Like, the older brother in me, she wants to like kick him out of the church. Like, we need a deacon meeting about this, you know. But eight hours a year is your application, Christian. You've been following Jesus more than 3.5 years. It's time for you to be a follow coach in our church. To commit to 8 hours a year to leading someone. That's your step. If you're a Christian, a new Christian, even I would even open this up. Even if you're not a Christian, you can go through follow. I would just encourage you when you sign up to let them know that you're not a Christian, and because we'll just match you up with a coach accordingly. And the beauty of follow is if you've been a Christian, you can come to Christ today, start follow tomorrow, 8 weeks from now, you can coach someone else through it. You can be a Christian for 8 weeks and help one of your friends. Because the follow is this, it's just an attitude like, hey, I'm as jacked up as you are, let's learn about Jesus. No one's perfect, I'm not perfect, you've heard it from me this morning, I'm not perfect. But we're learners. We learn, we humble ourselves, we change, and we lead. We change the world. And we're not going to stop until we reach just one more. Would you bow your heads? Let's pray. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for the work that you're doing in our lives. Thank you for the amazing opportunity we have to make an impact. I pray for anyone in here who's making the decision right now. They want to learn about you. They want to follow you. I pray they'll make the decision. They'll give their heart and their life to you right now. They just say a simple prayer. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. And I ask you to forgive me and help me to follow you. And you do it. You forgive them. You save them. You start the process of transforming and changing them. Thank you for everyone right now who's made that decision. Jesus, for the Christians, may we do what you called us to do. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.